this is what it kind of looks like inside the D, take a cross section of the D, most insects are similar to this. We have a ton of proboscis here, which is basically a, functions like a drinking straw. It folds the base of the head and allows the bee to suck up liquids like honey, for example, or water or nectar. And that liquid then goes into a honey stomach here, which is a temporary storage organ, and they then be passed down into this part. And they've got the digestive portion of the bee. And that's where the infection occurs. That's the critical part of the stomach. That's where so much of the nutrients are released from pollen. Microbe reproduces and interferes with the digestion of all this food. So there can be a serious problem with the queen bee, the worker bees, the drone bees, contamination of the queen bee that may lay 1,000 eggs a day or more, and all the food that she needs to eat and digest, metabolize, and turn into the link material. She's going to be greatly diminished in her eggplant abilities. If her digestive system is infected with millions and millions of these queen. So oftentimes you'll see queen bees that are disappear and replaced by daughter queens and those queen bees disappear. So a very serious problem with queen bees. And that's a big issue. And another issue is also queens don't do as long as they used to, they don't do as well as they used to. This is probably one of the problems, but also certainly some other serious problems. And then if we go down even to the cellular level, remember that all these tissues are made up of cells that are maybe 5, 10, 15 microns across. And this is the inside of the stomach. And it's a very small cutaway view of the stomach. This is the inside of the stomach. And this is the stomach itself. This is the outside of the stomach, inside the bee, where you have the blood and other organs distributed outside. This is a healthy bee right here. This is one cell right here. You can see these clear areas are probably full of nutrients that the cells are absorbing and saving for the bee. They also have some digestive enzymes in them. And then these are cells that are infected right here. You see all these dark things? Some of them look like little eyeballs. There's numerous, numerous, right in this cell alone. Remember, this is one very thin slice of three-dimensional structure. So imagine this being as big three dimensions since it is two dimensions. You can imagine many more microbes in that particular cell that are seen here. So look at this cell and cell and cell. Just about every cell is jammed with these infectious microbes. And we have just completely taken over the activity. And this is what is happening inside of the bee. There's a lot of spores are germinating. Just see all these lines. These are all those very thin polar filaments that are shooting out of the microbe. And this is actually simulated on a microscope slide. This is basically what it looks like. Each one being extremely thin, but each one allowing the passage of material that's inside the spore, which is the spore organisms, nucleus, and their proteins inside the machinery, their, all the DNA, the enzymes that they need. They take over their cell. They're just basically like pirates. They take over that cell and turn it to their own use. So here's what we want to try to do when we look at a problem. We try to do some controlled experiments. Okay, so we try to compare under conditions, see how some potential treatments for this disease. There is one treatment that works, but it's pretty expensive and it may have some significant side effects. It costs about $1 a hive to treat with this chemical. I mean, you have to do it probably 70 times a year. If you have at least for every 1,000 hives, you've got $1,000 of treatment for something. So it's very good to try to look for new treatments for this disease that are effective, easy, safe, perhaps less expensive than $1 a hive. And we want to look at interactions because actually in reality, all these different factors that are affecting bees, and this includes parasites, other diseases, nutrition, they all interact. feel we can't we care about ourselves. Same thing with these and all other such wordings. They are short on other essential things like nutrition, actions of parasites and so on. They too can be much more susceptible to these infectious diseases. And finally, we just want to look at the progression of the disease and just understand it. This is a relatively new problem. At least it's new to our understanding. It's been around for quite a while, but it's only really been recognized in the last few years. Same thing in Europe. It's in Europe, Canada, Australia, Asia, much of the world, South America, much of the world that has virtual BPD and RBD people in both does struggle with this problem. Most of the research is being done in North America and Europe. Actually, the first study most intensive was in Spain, long ago. And so we want to have some control experiments. We have one serious problem that sort of hit a bunch of us. Well, we just have a group of these and high cages here that have one treatment, some that have another treatment. We do an experiment, look at the data, and make some conclusions, but we actually have some problems in seeing reliable infections, which is so much funny because those diseases killing so many bees and so many hundreds of thousands of beehives. Why would we be having trouble getting these infections very high? And here's some situations. Up in Alberta, some of the colonies were artificially inactive and spontaneously recovered. In fact, they raised the need to send them some spores because they couldn't find any sick bees up there. They had made their bees sick earlier in the year, and then all the bees got healthy for no apparent reason. It's serious. Here at KSU and the other institutions, we've seen that bees sometimes don't get sick. We feed them thousands or millions of spores. Cages or outdoor hives, just not happening. That's kind of mysterious in itself. And then there's an experiment in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, the U.S. Department of Agriculture. They were taking healthy bees, and they put a little mark on them at the back, a little paint mark right between the wing and the back, and introduced them to a sick hive. Then they would go a couple weeks later, about 2 weeks later, and they would find those marked bees and pull them out again and see how sick they were. They wanted to understand the progression of the disease, how quickly these healthy bees got infected. And after a couple weeks, they found out that all these bees were still pretty much healthy. Okay, and just to see here, to show the picture of it, they tear it out, putting the bees, and this is probably an order of a few dozen bees, into the sick hives, and then a couple weeks later, they pull them out. Why these bees would not be sick? At least at first glance, this can't be right in the middle of understanding what they have. And sort of reminds me, I don't know if you've ever read any Sherlock Holmes stories, but there's a very good story about a mystery that Sherlock Holmes is concluded to solve, and it's about the theft of a racehorse, a very expensive horse that's been stolen. Stolen from a barn, and the night it was stolen, there was a dog and a bunch of farm hands that were sleeping in the barn. And one of the things that Holmes realizes is that the night the horse was stolen, people didn't wake up, and the reason they didn't wake up was because the dog was in the barn. The dog was supposed to be barred and carried the horse. And so the fact that the dog was in the barn was important to Holmes, which produced that while the dog was in his own, the person was in the horse. And so this is sort of the case for the absence of something that's very important. And then things started to fall together. It's a very good story. It's called Silver Blaze. A lot of very interesting clues and sort of observations that most people would not make. Things that should have happened but didn't. And it's a little bit the same here.